I I'm alive. Hello everybody, and thanks for joining us to discuss John Patrick Leary's new book, Keywords for Capitalism. Knew you were repulsed by a word, but didn't know why and what accounted for that repulsion. This is the place for you to be, because over the course of two books, John's previous book, Keywords for the titles are quite similar, and I'm going to talk about the difference between the two. Keywords, the new language of capitalism, which came out a few years ago, and this book, Keywords for Capitalism. John has really become the Raymond Williams of our time. Somebody has explored the language of power and dominance and the way that words are used to evade and lead. But what's particularly important about this book, Keywords for Capitalism, is that it does more than just chart the evasions. Keywords for a New Capitalism is his earlier book was a book that, looked at the language of neoliberalism and the language of HR. And I think John and I come out at NYU together, and I think we probably met and at least became friends during I guess the 2006 strike, TA strike, was that 2006, 2005? Something like that. And and perhaps no institution in US society other than every other institution has the ability to bastardize language like the university, to make it mean one thing when it means something else. To use the kind of soft language of the new economy to issue veiled threats against graduate students. And John's it's a lesson in the lexicon of evasion. And John's first book really got at the ways in which neoliberalism and human relations kind of watered down our language, for very real material reasons. And we all know the way the rise of talking about labor as human capital, words like synergy. This book is a little different though, and it's and in some ways it's much more important. It's a book that I think, particularly in this moment where language is so fraught and so explosive, and it seems that so much of our political struggles take place over the terrain of meaning, of words, on platforms that are nothing but words. This is a book that I think has the potential. I mean, it's not a big book. It's a book for our times in the sense that it's 140 word pages, like, kind of like 140 characters, but it seeks to, in my reading, to build solidarity, to you to return to the left an ability to use language to come together. And the way John does that is a very astute and perceptive reading, and often a very funny reading. I know John personally, and his mordant sense of dry humor comes out on almost every page. I'll just say one thing. He opens it up with a very nice set piece. A very nice scene of visiting his parents in the suburbs of Washington with his brother, and I guess he grew up there. And they used to be living next door, an old immigrant, Eastern European, Russian, maybe Ukrainian couple that according to the Leary, the gossip mill probably came from a Ukrainian aristocracy, but they were old Europe. And John spent many a lovely afternoon eating hard candy in their mahogany and dark draped meeting room, dining room, gathering room, whatnot. And recently he went back with his brother, and that couple is gone. They were an older couple, and a new Washington Power couple has moved in. And during some Christmas social event, he is probably seems to be, according to John, a lawyer somewhere downtown in Washington, D.C., asked his brother John the question, so do you follow politics? and from that word politics, John opens up this kind of whole world, semantic world in which we're trapped into in many ways, which we're imprisoned in, and what politics means. And it's really a wonderful book. So I'll just John, who teaches in Philadelphia in a public school. He's also the author of a book on Latin America, on cultural history of underdevelopment, Latin America in the U.S. imagination, and the previous keyword book that I mentioned. So welcome, John. This is really a pleasure, and thank you for asking me to do this.
Oh, thanks for doing it, Greg. Thanks for the kind introduction. It's very flattering to be referred to as the Raymond Williams of our time. I don't know if I can live up to that, given that I'm so heavily indebted to the Raymond Williams of the 70s, but thank you nonetheless. The title of the book, I also keep forgetting the title of this.
I know, as I was getting ready, I was like, wait, which is which? Which was the one that came out?
I keep having to Google it. It's for ease of, to make it easy for us, and to be clear, I sometimes just, keywords one, keywords two is how I've shorthanded it to myself.
Yeah.
So thanks a lot again. So the this book, I would say you started by talking about some of the differences. So maybe we can begin with that. I mean, the opening story about this kind of annoying neighbor of my parents who asked my brother. And the thing that was particularly annoying about it to me at the time was that my brother was about the same age as this guy. And he said, so he was like, so are you interested in politics? Like, he was a precocious little kid, and the kind of condescension was hard to distinguish from that banal understanding of what politics was, the sort of the thing that happens on TV, or the thing that sort of qualified and very smart people downtown in DC do. And so the book is kind of divided into various sort of rejoinders or various ways of understanding that guy's meaning of politics and that question. So the book's divided into kind of three categories of terms. And one is the horse race. So the words that we encounter in kind of electioneering and election coverage in basically mainstream news media discussion of, the government, basically. And then politics as the place of movements in which average people participate. Since the main difference, the metaphor of the horse race is sort of an appropriate one for politics as it's conducted in official circles and on TV, because the horse race is a sport in which like only a unique species can participate. Like all we can do is watch, we're not horses. So the movement chapter is about the time when we get to enter, as it were, the race. And then the last section is structures. So the kinds of things that probably that neighbor would not have considered if, we had answered him like, yeah, we're really interested in the class question and racism and the place of materialism in contemporary American society. Those sorts of questions that one wouldn't really compute with somebody who's sort of steeped in that horse race stuff.
Yeah, I think we all have, I mean, leftists have all had that moment where you run into, I mean, this person seemed particularly obnoxious, and the juxtaposition with the loss of a kind of old world gentility, no matter how probably odious their politics, they probably were. They were all, they fled the Russian Revolution.
I never discussed it, so I can't remember.
Yeah. I'm a nostalgist and a declinist, so like, you know, the loss of that kind of old world and in its place coming, you know, what has come was a very graphic image. But we've all had trouble. I mean, we've all, I think, run into people that are interested in, I mean, this person seemed particularly obnoxious and wanted to talk about politics as a horse race, and, you know, as MSNBC, as you know, 538, as polling, as repeating conventional wisdom, as, you know, channeled through cable TV, but the same five people. But you know, there is also a kind of, you know, another category of people who want to talk about politics that are generally liberal and progressive, but don't have the apparatus to talk about, you know, to get beyond, to break out of that miasma that you capture so well. And I think that's what your book does. It gives people a kind of roadmap to get out of the, you know, to break out of the MSNBC prison house, the prison.
I didn't, and this is, I guess, one difference between, you know, Keywords 1 and Keywords the sequel, is the, you know, the first book was just about terms to avoid, basically. I mean, like, all of them were evasions, as you said, like entrepreneurship and innovation are just ways of not saying what you should be saying, or human capital is a way of not saying labor, and leadership is just a way of not saying the boss, you know, that kind of stuff. So, but I didn't want to just sort of categorize all the like dumb things people say on MSNBC, you know, in part because it's easy, and but in part because, you know, the dumb things people say on MSNBC can be kind of ways of getting to other things, or ways of kind of reframing other questions. And so, you know, talking about the history of, say, like the term, the kitchen table.
Yeah.
But this idea of like kitchen table issues, is this kind of like banal term that you almost barely at this point, and this is kind of like the function of terms like this, you just don't even think about what it means or what it might mean when you hear it. You just, it's a word that, a term that we are allowed to be complacent about.
Yeah.
And to just sort of have it roll off our backs. But when one digs into its history, it's sort of a more interesting history than you might think. And, you know, it has a origin story as women from the Association of University Women coins it in like a focus group in Iowa before the primaries, before the Dukakis election, the 88 primary or 87 or whatever primaries. And, you know, it's a way of trying to leverage the attention of the Democratic Party to focus on home care, women's wages, elder care, and the sorts of political issues that would have been categorized as like women's issues. And so what this woman's effort was to do was to kind of make it a central plank rather than a kind of marginal plank of the party. And it's now become, you know, a kind of marginal plank, precisely from the overuse of the term kitchen table issues to just sort of suggest, you know, all sorts of things like the household metaphor for national finances. You know, it sometimes suggests that, like when a politician will say, like, we have to balance our budget, like your house balances its budget, that sort of thing. or it just refers to like important stuff and in the most general sense. But so like sort of digging into that term kind of might I hope anyway help us sort of extract the meaningful core from all of the sort of bullshit it's been submerged in.
Yeah, and it's also linked to, I mean, it's one thing to talk about kitchen table kitchen table politics or kitchen table issues, but if they're, it's when they're linked to, technocratic solutions that are, part of the whole general switch to bipartisanship, compromise, a kind of, a hollowing out of a New Deal concept of redistribution. I mean, one could imagine kitchen table issues being, national health care being, including dental insurance but it was as you write, it's the language of patriarchy, the kitchen table, balancing the budget, home economics 101 applied to politics. So it's the kind of reinforcing and reimagining the patriarchy, but in this age of neoliberal capitalism.
Yeah. So the story, the Dukakis like fails to, go anywhere with this term or with this concept. And then when Clinton tries to do his, health reform in 93 or whenever it was, the famous ad of, now I'm forgetting her name, Louise and...
Oh, Harriet and
somebody? Harry and Louise, some of that?
You're talking about the healthcare.
Yeah, sorry. They're sitting at the dinner table, at the kitchen table, and the husband is kind of like aloof and oblivious, and he's reading the paper, like ignoring his wife, and then she's reading the bill, like, and it's this like doorstop of a bill, and she's sort of comes out with all this kind of homespun wisdom about how oppressive it's going to be and how much it's going to ruin them, and they say, and that ad is kind of often credited with sort of galvanizing opposition to this signature issue, like this fundamental issue of what was initially supposed to be a kitchen table issue, but now it's used to signify the kind of authority of the home and the kind of fortress of the home against intrusion of the welfare state or against the intrusion of like a collective, enterprise of any kind.
And certainly, certainly the New Deal rebuilt and stabilized the patriarchal family and the male's role in it, even as it created opportunities in other ways for women. But it's one thing to restabilize the patriarchal family around an economics of however flawed economic redistribution, as opposed to restructuring, reimagining the patriarchal family in an age in which, the gutting of the welfare state and the turn towards market solutions to solve all problems and the dominance of corporations and all of the paperwork and bureaucracy and humiliation that goes with corporate rule.
Yeah.
One of the things that I was struck, I had no idea about this, and I guess once I read it, it was like, oh yeah, of course, that Barack Obama used the word folk more than...
Not folk, but, folks, plural, yeah.
Folks more than any other president, but I don't know if you quantified it.
Somebody did. Like orders of magnitude more than anyone else had ever said folks.
Yeah, so I mean, what was that? That's like, so, again, like all of these words you could see in a Frank Capra New Deal movie, but they would have a completely different valence, right?
Yeah, so I mean, the one argument, the reasonable argument in favor of folks. So this is an example of where, this book isn't just about naughty words that one should stop using, because folks has a certain utility in English for addressing a collective of people.
Yeah.
We don't have a second person.
Tortured some folks.
In his kind of signature, you know, style of speaking, we tortured. And then he followed it up with the kind of scolding of, you know, left-wing critics not to be too sanctimonious about the tough job that those folks had done in Iraq. And so in the space of two sentences, he A, referred to torture victims as some folks, and then like also used folks to refer to their torturers. And so it was this kind of remarkable evasion of any kind of distinction between those two, or responsibility, a moral difference that might exist between torturers and their victims. And so for me, like, besides just the grammatical utility of folks, the way that it becomes important in kind of political discourse, and why it's, I think, a certain way, a good way of capturing a certain feature of Obama style liberalism, is that it's supposed to conjure the sort of national cross-party consensus that basically denies the, or at least downplays the persistence of fundamental conflicts, like, you know, class conflict, racial conflict, conflict in the sort of literal sense of an imperial war in Iraq, and all of the kind of violence that conjured up. So it was his overuse of the word folks is, I think, kind of part of, is a rhetorical tick that was revelatory of a certain refusal to actually engage those very real conflicts, and to sort of conjure this sort of phony consensus that is much harder, I think, now to believe in, even if, you know, Biden is sort of desperately trying to keep its flame burning.
Yeah, I mean, it reminded me of, you know, Graham Greene and Amen Nirvana has that famous passage that there exists two types of people in the world, the torturable and the untorturable. You know, there's two classes, you know, the torturable and the untorturable. And then he has a riff on that, you know, who's torturable and who's untorturable. And he said, you know them when you see them, you know, and all of that stuff. And here, you know, I mean, not to make too much of it, but here Obama is basically saying we're all torturable. I mean, if we're all folks, the folks are being tortured and the folks are doing the torturing, then we're all part of the torturable class at this point.
Rhetorical tick that all politicians, a sort of fake populism that all politicians engage in.
Yeah. Well, you know, that also brings to, you know, the foreign policy dimensions of a lot of this. You know, this, I mean, you for the most part focus on capitalism as the context in which language is formed and fought over and contested and deformed, and you know, and not to make any kind of big analytical distinction between the two, but, you know, militarism has its own, you know, this kind of endless war and constant warfare has its own impact on language. You know, there's an essay, I'm not a big fan of Arthur Schlesinger Jr., but he does have this really wonderful essay at the end of the Vietnam War about how, you know, the constant militarism of the United States by this point, I think Laos, Cambodia had been revealed, and the full nature and extent of what the United States was doing. I don't know, maybe the Church Committee had revealed it. I don't know, but he talked about, you know, there's been a semantic collapse. Militarism has caused a semantic collapse that has disassociated words from their meanings, you know, and it's just interesting. He doesn't make that much of it, but, you know, when you think of the kind of world we live in, of constant misinformation and hard to pin things down, you know, the kind of crisis of false news and misinformation, it's often not traced back to the history of endless counterinsurgency and endless psychological warfare, which has you know, contributed to the defamation of language to some degree. But there is one. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Mm-hmm. But there is. This is all just to get to the one big example in the book and that you have that does make this connection and to some degree is filibuster. You want to say a little bit about, you know, the origins of the word filibuster and how it circles back from the foreign to the domestic?
Yeah. So filibuster is a word that comes to at least our language from Spanish, from filibustero, which is a word that was used to refer to kind of privateers or private military operators in the Caribbean in the 19th century. And so the greatest of them all, the most relatively successful, was William Walker, who was a Tennessean who formed a private army to invade and briefly occupy Nicaragua in 1850. I'm forgetting, maybe you know, 1852 or anyway, 1850s. And he, with backing from some southern slave agriculture interests, he occupies the country, briefly, you know, assumes power there, reinstitutes slavery, or at least attempts to, before he's overthrown and summarily executed by a United Central American Army. And so in Central America, his name is pretty well known. I mean, and the story is pretty well known because it's a sort of moment of kind of a anti-imperial heroism to overthrow him and execute him. But, you know, he's not remembered here at all, because this is like the history of filibustering. It's not just William Walker. There's Narciso Lopez, who goes to Cuba twice and fails twice. So this kind of tradition, or this history of mobilizing private armies to conquer territory in Latin America and Caribbean for the purposes of just brute exploitation and the purposes of instituting and expanding slavery is just like, you know, this is a major part of American foreign policy in the Americas in the 19th century that we don't really, that many people don't know about, I think, in this country. And so it's, for me, what it's very interesting, and it's, there is a kind of clear lineage from this kind of racist adventurism of filibustering to the way that the term has become used in kind of legislative procedure in the United States as a way of mostly blocking civil rights legislation. So in the 30s and before, in the Jim Crow era, to filibuster is generally to, it's not worth getting into all the arcane kind of Senate rules about why you can do it, but to interrupt legislation on civil rights. It's like the kind of go-to policy for that. And then now it's kind of been, I guess, expanded perhaps somewhat. It is not only used, although it is very much still used to disrupt civil rights legislation or legislation that has to do with racial justice, but it's also, right now invoked for abortion rights, to block abortion rights or to take them away, and it's it's an example of the way of like a, one way in which this kind of history of racist violence and conquest in the 19th century sort of still haunts the present by kind of. But particularly in an interesting way now, because it's the filibuster is, we think of it, I think we talk about it mostly as a sign of American just impotence and incompetence or failure, you know, right? Like in the current political context, filibustering is just like a sign of what a fiasco American government has become. But it has this very kind of aggressive and very deliberate and very kind of a focused campaign history, you know?
Right.
This militaristic campaign history.
Yeah, yeah. And then there's a lot of ways, I think, there's a lot of the language, the way language has been incorporated, that, you know, you pull out the word. And, you know, earlier on I mentioned Raymond Williams, but there's a long history of this kind of exposition, this kind of using language to, you know, get beyond what, and the other thing, just more because I think he captured Raymond Williams, I think you carry on the best tradition of Raymond Williams in terms of his analytical abilities, but there's another, Ambrose Bierce, you know, who wrote the devil, you know, he had his column in San Francisco, Devil's Dictionary, and he was quite the critic of capital and labor and colonialism. You know, he himself saw language as a way of as mystification. You know, as a way of, you know, like he put out this, what he called the Devil's Dictionary, which we define. So labor is one, his definition of labor is one of the processes by which A acquires property from B. And then he goes on to talk about land, a part of the earth's surface considered as property. The theory that land is property subject to private ownership is the foundation of modern society and eminently worthy of superstructure. Carried to its logical conclusion, it means that some have the right to prevent others from living. For the right to own implies the right exclusively to occupy. And in fact, laws of trespass are enacted whenever property in land is recognized. It follows that if the whole area of terra firma is owned by A, B, and C, there will be no place for D, E, F, and G to be born, or born as trespassers. I mean, it's kind of remarkable entry, considering, you know, that, you know, one, he's writing at the tail end of Frederick Jackson Turner and the whole myth of the frontier, and two, he's foreshadowing, you know, a whole class of people who will have no place to be. But yeah. Anyway, I just wanted to also say that you were not just you do not just invoke Raymond Williams in analysis. You invoke Ambrose Bierce in his wit and humor.
Oh well, thanks. It's good company to be in. I am a big fan of the Devil's Dictionary. I mean, it's it is kind of remarkable how kind of you know, I think the title is meant to refer to the kind of the deeply kind of cynical, sardonic vehemence of a lot of his definitions, like the one you just read, and, like, you know, one of my favorites is marriage. I can't remember his definition of it, but something for our listeners to look up.
Well, one of my favorites is emancipation, because it's so Foucauldian. I mean, I'm not particular. I mean, but emancipation is, he defines it as a bondsman, a slave's change from the tyranny of another to the despotism of himself. He was a slave. At word he went and came. His iron collar cut him to the bone. Then liberty erased his own, his name, and tightened the rivets and inscribed his own. I mean, you know, it's just about the, you know, it's hard to get something better about the way that we internalize self-discipline and you know, modernity via a process of abstract control and self enslavement in some ways. So anyway, he was quite prescient in many of his entries.
And I guess, you know, in a way that's like, I don't quite share his I don't know, writing style, but his conciseness, I guess, either. But there's something about, you know, his general approach to language as something that, on the one hand, conceals, and that we can kind of crack open what it and see what it conceals when it's used as sort of like land or emancipation, is to kind of promise something that it doesn't deliver, or promise something that comes with a catch attached, or with a, you know, and then but that also language is something which we use in ways that kind of, you know, sometimes undermine us, and sometimes what things that we, which we use for our own kind of political purposes. So not just like, again, not just sort of like bad words that are pure deception or pure mystification or pure evasion, but concepts that we can't avoid, but which bear within it some kind of meaning, which if we kind of drill down on it or access it, can illuminate some aspect of our political right. world. You know, like the land definition was a pretty good one, I think. In that, you know, we can't avoid talking about it. We can't avoid walking on it. We can't avoid trespassing or buying or renting it. And so
there's a material reality undergirding this that ultimately can't, and it's not all. I mean, you have that quote by Michael Denning that I marked it, but now I can't find it.
What's that? Populace.
Yeah, we'd all. Yeah, if politics were all words, we'd all be populists. Is that the?
Let me give it to you exactly. I know what page it's on. If language were politics, we would all be populists.
Yeah. And so what can you maybe I speak a little bit more on that? Because that obviously, you know, has had an enormous impact on politics in Latin America that I know the most of, where you know, La Clau and Mao's hegemony and a socialist strategy, the really final break with discourse from a kind of material class politics in the final instance, that it is about coming up with a kind of populist assemblage that somehow speaks to the people. And, you know, that was Chavez, and that's the, you know, that and to a large degree that's been at least one of the main frameworks in which the strength and weakness of the left in Latin America has taken place in. But I take it that you see limits in that, and that there are some connection. You can't completely demoor these words from the materiality and class relations. Not materiality, yeah, but the class relations of things.
Yeah, and not just class relations, but all of the sort of social, I mean, in the broader sort of like ideological, all the kinds of social networks in which language takes shape, in which it's embedded, you know, racial, class, sexuality, and so on. I mean, I think what Denning is saying there, as I understand it, is to point to, yeah, the way in which if a kind of populist language that a politician or a pundit uses, like a kind of language of kind of democratic legitimacy, or dropping your G's when you're speaking at a barbecue, or, you know, riding a motorcycle during the like election to show that you're a salt of the earth regular guy, all those sorts of things. If all of these sort of like linguistic performances hide a material reality, right? I mean, that sometimes they articulate it and express it, and sometimes they are merely hiding it. And so what I try to do in that particular, this is the folks chapter, you know, again, is to sort of talk about some of the ways in which this word like actually gets used and some of those performances, but also to talk about some of that kind of material reality that sort of undergirds and gives shape to the term, and also kind of like shows us some of what's wrong with it. So I mean, one example is just the torture regime that Obama's kind of sunny use of folks allowed us to not think about. But then also the kind of the ways in which like folks and who counts as a member of the folk is in American history always deeply embedded in racial and regional prejudice and class conflicts. So, you know, the real folks who are invoked by the politicians' rhetorical gesture, seemingly populist gesture, to the folks is the real folks might be Black industrial workers, but they might be white Southerners. They might be small town shopkeeper. They might be, you know, like who Sarah Palin was talking about when she long ago talked about real Americans, or who Trump addresses when he's talking about my people. So those kinds of meanings are very flexible, but they're often kind of, they're like, as you were saying with the Obama example, I mean, there's often a kind of very sinister edge underneath it that, you know, we have to be kind of.
Yeah, and I noticed that you didn't bring in reference to Volk, the connection to.
Well, this is keywords in American English.
No, the Volkish, you know. it's not unrelated, the search for the pure, the national subject that's pure. And, you know, obviously that is very elusive and adaptable and can change. I mean, you can have African-American fascists and Republicans. I mean, this is, a, you know, there is a, but anyway, that's a little bit off track. We've given a bunch of Ambrose Bierce's definitions, but maybe we can turn to a few of your favorite ones. And also, I want to say I didn't get the final copy of the book. I got the galleys, but apparently, the book is illustrated with a number of not the book I have, but the book is illustrated that you will get when you go out and buy it by Felicia Wolf. Is that right?
And Felicia did these amazing illustrations for each entry and for a few sort of things in between.
Yeah. So apparently the lovely and evocative illustrations of each of different keywords. What's your favorite keyword?
Like my favorite entry?
Your favorite entry, yeah.
Right. It's one like choosing your favorite child, Greg. I don't know.
people have them. Don't
your least favorite them. Child.
Don't let them kid you. They have their favorite child.
I don't know. I mean, maybe my favorite illustration is the way to approach it. I mean, I think we have Felicia's drawing for ideology is available.
We have a slide of it.
The people behind the curtain to show us. So, so in the entry on ideology, you know, which is a word that, again, this is like an example of a term that has a certain kind of, you know, stupid meaning in the sort of horse race media sphere, which, you know, is part of what I'm trying to do in the book, is to sort of address some of that, you know, the way we access politics in language, like in social media, in the media, in the written word, wherever we encounter it. But it also has a kind of rich history in European politics and Marxist theory spanning the globe. So I try to sort of give a really brief sketch of, I think, the most important parts of that. So, you know, ideology, the dumb meaning, is just sort of like a bad idea or an extreme idea. So like when somebody wants to denounce their opponent's, you know, politics, they say, my opponent is guided by ideology, whereas I'm guided by common sense and data or something. You know, I mean, that's like sort of that kind of opposition is very common now. Like ideology is unreasonable and irrational in one's own. Like one never has an ideology. It's always something you accuse someone else of having. But Felicia's illustration here is a toad sitting on a mushroom in a garden, and it's a reference to Stuart Hall, the critic, Jamaican British critic, who wrote an essay called "The Toad in the Garden" about ideology and politics in Britain in the 70s and 80s. And so, what briefly, like what he's talking about, you know, he thinks about ideology as the set of mental frameworks, like the languages, the terms, concepts, the representations, like works of art, music, films, media, slang, the way people talk, the way people interact, the way people dress, which classes and social groups use to make sense of the world and to understand the way society works. I mean, that's a sort of, I think, a pretty decent just definition of ideology. We could just end there. But the toad in the garden kind of metaphor, I think, captures one thing about a kind of certain Marxist tradition of ideology, which Hall was arguing with, which is to say that, you know, ideology is just, as it were, the superstructure, the ways in which the real determining factors that shape society, the, you know, what happens in the workplace, the factory, the economic conditions, the material, that is to say, like, economic base of society. In ideology, is just sort of like the deceptions that come from kind of bourgeois media or bourgeois ideas, and then the kind of more correct or more militant, more socialist ideas that one might get from a kind of more like proletarian media. I mean, so that's sort of like as a certain kind of Soviet like notion of what ideology was. And so he's trying to argue with this and to say that the ways in which like average people, you know, make sense of the world and come to understand how society works often complicates, contradicts, surprises, introduce new forms of struggle, new forms of reaction, as he was observing in Britain in the 80s. Thatcher was coming up. And so the ways in which people make sense of the world, make sense of society, often sort of complicates the theoretical models that we and that, you know, sort of theoreticians or kind of political theorists or political analysts bring to make sense of what's happening. And so we might have a pretty beautiful, well-ordered, well-tidy garden to explain what's happening, but there are these there are people, and there are their kind of vagaries and their surprises, and they kind of come like a toad to obstruct all the pretty well-ordered theories that we have.
Are people seeing this image now? I don't see it on my screen. Is it being shown to the audience? Do we know? It is being shown to the audience, even though we can't see it. Okay.
And so Felicia made a little motif throughout the book of this toad. He became kind of, for me and for our editor John and for Felicia, this toad became sort of a fan favorite and is sort of a mascot of the book. So, you know, for me, like, what I like about it, I think, is this goes back to, I think, something you said in your introduction about one of the purposes of the book is to sort of help build solidarity. I mean, because especially on the left, you know, historically, language and the correct use and what are the proper things to call things is a source of great conflict, and often people kill each other over these kind of arguments. And so what I wanted to do, and you know, you see this in like a kind of more petty form on like social media where people argue about like neoliberalism, or people argue about like intersectionality, and usually in sort of petty ways or trivial ways about what class means and what materialism means and why identity politics isn't materialist, or you know, all sorts of kind of arguments like that. And I wanted to both introduce readers or sort of survey some of those arguments to the degree that they're legitimate arguments. But I was also really trying my best here to be kind of as generous as I can to, because, you know, the point of, say, a word like intersectionality, which has been so, I think, misapprehended by various kinds of people for various reasons, is that it is about, if you go to the, you know, the Combi River Collective Statement on Identity Politics, which I begin that essay with, and which is sort of a major text in the sort of history of this concept, the purpose is to restore a sense of the lived material reality of people who are marked in the United States as Black women, or as disabled people, or as queer people, and whose kind of way of inhabiting the world and of making sense of how the world works, you know, to go back to the ideology example, is indelibly shaped by that kind of material reality, which has very kind of tangible, physical, well, deeply felt effects on how you live your life. And so it is to, you know, to pay attention to these things is to sort of do a materialist analysis of the class conflict in the United States today. And so what I wanted to, you know, I wanted to try to like work against the tendency, especially talking about, you know, language and its meaning, to sort of ascertain the right meaning, or to sort of scold those who have used terms incorrectly, or to, you know, to own my to own like people online, or to, you know, to like work against that kind of I think unconstructive like form of discourse, and to instead, you know, give people a sort of a some kind, not just a roadmap to all the sort of dumb things they say on MSNBC, but some of the ways in which language might help be a roadmap to kind of building the alliances and building the kind of connections that like inevitably have to be made in a country like ours to do anything constructive. And so the toad, this, I started talking about this because of the toad, didn't I? I mean, I like the toad as this sort of mischievous figure who comes in and, you know, just sits there, and you can't ignore him, and you can't just toss him aside, and he messes with your kind of pretty mental models of how things are supposed to be, but you have to figure out a way to incorporate him into your program.
Like the frog and the toad. and also it's a nice subversion of an image that has been, you know, taken commandeered by the right.
I had to, before we came on live, I had to explain to Greg the difference between a frog like Pepe the Frog and a toad.
Very important. Something about water and anyway, I think to go back to what you were just saying, I think you've done a great job at doing that. I mean, I think it's a good, it's a foundation to help with solidarity and both to understand the linguistic stakes, which are real, and to find common ground. And it's definitely a project that we should, you know, continue. I mean, it's the need for unity obviously is is more urgent than ever. And I think your book does a wonderful job at laying at least the beginnings, the foundation for kind of to find that kind of common ground in words and how to, and a method for doing it also as well, for other people to continue and for you to continue. So I think we have a half an hour left, and I guess we will maybe opening it up for questions.
Mm-hmm. So one is, you could maybe give them the title of that essay.
Somebody wants to know the name of the Schlesinger essay. I don't remember. I cited it in that Kissinger's shadow book. He uses it big point of the essay is anti-Kissinger. I can't remember the essay. I'll have to look for it. But it's in Kissinger's shadow.
So there was a question about ideological assumptions. So the question, I'll just read it so that you can see it. You mentioned that definitions are very fraught, especially among socialists. Don't all definitions come with certain ideological assumptions? How do you handle the dilemma in the book? And absolutely they do. I think that's part of the reason why I think why I wrote the book and why I'm interested in this kind of model of analysis is that how we name a problem or how we name a solution is kind of determines much of how we respond and how we kind of conceptualize a problem, how we formulate the solution. So I guess I would answer the question with socialism, which the questioner asks, and what I do there, I mean, there are many arguments about the meaning of that word, what socialism is, what it should be, what real socialism is, or what really existing socialism is, or what it wasn't. So part of what I'm doing in the book is kind of just charting those. I mean, giving, you know, there's a certain kind of encyclopedic, because I don't think it's quite as dry as that, but I'm trying to give people a kind of useful overview that they can use, and a fair overview. But the ideological kind of, one of the kind of major conflicts in the history of the word socialism has to do with just the word itself, like what is the social that is referenced in that word socialism. And there's like, you know, a couple at least of traditions of answering that question. One is to say that it is the kind of truest fulfillment of the social compact of liberalism, like rights and obligations in a society that is a free society. And then there's the kind of the definition of socialism that kind of becomes more dominant after the Russian Revolution, that says that the liberal tradition's embrace of property rights is a kind of insuperable obstacle to realizing a free society. So that there's this conflict between these two kind of conceptions. And certain sort of socialists like Big Bill Haywood in the United States and Eugene Debs in the United States try to kind of thread this needle by talking about industrial democracy as a form of socialist reorganization of the means of production of society that would also realize the kind of ideal of a free society whose government is of and by and for the people, as Debs said. The ideological assumptions are kind of implicit in the word and the way one uses it. The point isn't to kind of resolve them or to kind of arrive at the point is not to resolve them or arrive at the correct meaning, but to make people aware of the kind of range of the kind of capacity, the capaciousness of the concept of socialism and how much it can include and how much it has included. So that, and I think when you look at, like, say, the example of Haywood and Debs, it's like, we can see how these kinds of ideological assumptions that may be in conflict can also be kind of, can also be resolved and can be addressed in a kind of spirit, again, of like, solidarity, rather than viewing these kind of questions as like a fight to the death, as we often do.
Do you want to take the next one about the word tax eater, which I've actually never heard before?
I have. The question is, someone used the word tax eater as an antonym to taxpayer. So tax eaters are people who consume taxes, and taxpayers are the ones who pay them. Basically the question is, what about taxpayer? And that's a good one. I feel like I wrote about this somewhere, but not in here, not in this book. So I think it's a great word. I mean, not a great word, but a great word for me to forget, because it's full of, it captures a lot about a kind of a certain, I think, neoliberal understanding of government and how wealth is created and how it's distributed. So when a sort of politician says, like, the taxpayers of this country won't stand for whatever expenditure, or taxpayer dollars are being wasted on, you know, school lunch for kindergartners or whatever, what we're doing, we're kind of reverting to this sort of notion of a society as like a kind of a dollar store or convenience store in which individuals pay their way and get a commodity in exchange, which I guess is like membership in a society or something. It treats every kind of, it understands every individual as a kind of a solitary, autonomous individual whose wealth is their own, who is completely at liberty from any obligation to someone else, except to the degree that there's this sort of onerous debt you have to pay to, you know, maybe keep the roads paved and to keep the military armed and so forth. So I guess the basic problem for me of taxpayer is that the way in which it sort of atomizes us all into these kind of like service purchasing units rather than members of a society with shared obligations and rights. I don't know, would you add anything, Greg, to that? Or do you agree?
No, I mean, I was just thinking, Keynes is famous, taxes are the price we pay for civilization, you know, and how going back to the materiality of it all, how much of the taxes go to making war and destroying civilizations. I think that all of the debates take place within that bracketed context that's never really discussed. I can't imagine another country in which the criticism of the hatred of taxes has such a legitimate foundation, but used for but for the most pernicious ends, right? Taxes. I mean, what do people get for paying taxes in this country? It's remarkable. I mean, you don't get healthcare, you don't get education, you get like an incredibly skewed, you know, elementary school education system. You get a war machine that is capable of fighting, you know, 12 wars at, you know, simultaneously.
It's like a dollar store, a dollar store where they don't have anything and somebody might shoot you at any moment from behind the counter.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, somebody just said one German word for worker is
work taker.
Yeah, work taker, Arbeitnehmer, an employer is work giver. Wow, which is obviously very ideological, but Germans tend to just accept that. Have you found in your foreign, have you done any foreign language comparisons that helps you to make English words strange? If so, do you have any examples? I mean, I asked you about Volk and Folk earlier.
Yeah, that's a good question. The one that comes to mind that I talk about here, I mean, there are a lot. But the one that comes to mind right away is pueblo, and then pueblo in French and Spanish and French. So I talk about people, or the people, in the American context, and the way in which the American people, what the American people means when we hear it spoken generally by, you know, politicians, to invoke a kind of unified national community, kind of in the way, you know, much like folks does. And the way that pueblo makes that word feel newly strange is the way in which, you know, in Spanish it can refer to so many different kind of units of population. It can refer to a people in the sense of a nation, like the way that the American people does. Or it can refer to a town, it can refer to an immigrant disease, or it can refer to a part of a nation that is like the real part, or the most deserving part, or the part that has earned, you know, nationhood, or has paid the price or whatever against another part of the pueblo that is the exploiter or the elite. So, I mean, so the word in Spanish kind of made more clear to me how kind of empty and how vacuous often the way which we invoke the American people is as a way of just sort of papering over all of these distinctions that we know are here and that we know exist, and we talk about them constantly, you know, how bitterly divided the American people are, how polarized we are. But it's an example of the ways in which our language sort of allows us to pretend that those divisions, at least for a moment, don't exist. So the pueblo is a good example. And
And pueblo and juxtaposed to folk, there's less of a.
Yeah.
I might not just be getting it, being a, you know, a first language English language, but there seems to be less of a sinister quality or potential to pueblo than there is to folk.
Yeah, and also the people, in the sense of.
Yeah.
So vested with nationalism.
Yeah, and the national popular and
So, you know, like pueblo is a kind of fluctuating term that's appropriate to a place that is marked by borders that is crossed by all kinds of competing allegiances and power blocks and so forth, which the United States also is, but we don't kind of, we like to think about the national integrity of the United States as just like unimpeachable and uncrossable.
Going back to the example the questioner gave, I mean, work taker, it's very ideological, but to me, it sounds almost like more, I mean, to because when you think about the language of the right, that, you know, there's the takers and the makers, to actually call the employer the taker. German word for worker is work taker.
Yeah, so work giver just sounds like job.
How is that even? Oh, they're taking work. I get it.
The boss is the job creator and the worker is the person who's.
But great. I guess technically it means they're, but I guess, I don't know, I don't speak German, but I guess it technically doesn't mean that that they're being a taker, that it means that they're taking a job.
Yeah.
Right.
Seems related to the taker maker thing in Yuan, right. Since the takers are the parasites. So we have another question coming in over the wire here.
Do we? Yeah. Well, I think Lawson is following up.
Okay. Yeah. I do. The question is, do I talk about diversity, equity, and inclusion? And in fact, I talk about all three. I talk about diversity and inclusion in one entry on inclusion, and then equity in a separate, separate entry. So yeah, I'm grateful for this question actually, because we had talked about covering these, and I totally forgot about them. So yeah, diversity and inclusion, I write about them in the same entry, because you know the way in which they get used kind of by people who like those terms and think that they're great, or at least professionally are required to use those terms, since that's one of the ways in which they circulate, is as a kind of human resources or you know, definitely a university kind of bureaucracy jargon. So you know, they're in certain ways unavoidable for many people. Inclusion, I think, is supposed to be sort of diversity put into action. That's the way it's supposed to be, how it's supposed to work. So diversity is a sort of ideal, and inclusion is the way in which you get your organization. So what I talk about in the chapter is, I mostly compare inclusion to a word that I think it kind of summons, at least by kind of both lexically and also kind of historically, which is integration. Basically, you know, I think the idea, like integration, take the example from the US Civil Rights Movement, regardless of whether you think this actually happened or not, the purpose, the sort of stated purpose, the ideal of integration, is that it would transform a racist society. Since if a Southern Jim Crow society is sort of built around the fundamental presumption of white superiority and white supremacy, and its laws are sort of permeated by that assumption, integration would dramatically transform the terms in which the society worked. I mean, so you can argue whether that happened or not, but that's the idea. But inclusion kind of abandons, I think, a lot of that ambition, and it doesn't presume that there's anything fundamentally wrong or fundamentally wrong with an organization, because we don't really use inclusion at the level of a society, but only at the level of an institution. It doesn't presume that there's anything sort of fundamentally wrong with the institution that needs to change. It's rather more people should be brought into the thing as it currently exists. So that's, I think, the kind of part about the word that should be, I think, resisted, I think, because it, you know, because it's basically such a demobilizing term, and it's very flattering in that respect to whatever institution or whatever kind of bureaucracy is promoting it, because it's sort of saying, you know, it's absolving itself of really needing to change very much, except to just like add more people to this thing we have. And the example that I give, it's a sort of extreme example maybe, but an outrageous one that I couldn't believe it when I read it, was from the from a little flyer produced by the CIA on inclusion, diversity, inclusion, and equity at the CIA. It had all these little capsule biographies of various people who exemplified the CIA's commitment to inclusion. And there's one who's this white woman, And the brochure emphasizes that the picture may or may not actually be the person in question, and I guess so as not to reveal sensitive details about agents in the field. But she's a white woman in the picture, so I'm assuming that's what she is. And she talks about how she wasn't like some cosseted middle class kid who went to a good college and grew up in the suburbs. She grew up in a war zone. And from a very early age, she had to learn to defend herself. She drove a pickup truck with weapons and like learned to handle a assault rifle to fight against assailants and so on and so forth. And so she is an example because she comes from this kind of unconventional for the U.S. government life background. But then she explains at the end that she's a native of Rhodesia and that she grew up in Rhodesia in the 70s and 80s. And so I was like, okay, so you were like a guerrilla, you were a soldier for an apartheid regime. And it was like the most, I couldn't have like written a better conclusion, So equity, maybe we can talk about that for a second, because we have images all queued up, I think. Equity is a term that's also counterposed to another one, which is equality. And briefly, equality is, if we're looking at this like illustration here, there's like three kids or three people watching a baseball game. And there's a tall one who can see over the fence just fine. And then there's a sort of medium height one who stands on a like wooden pallet or something. And he can see over he can see over the thing. And then there's this other kid who just like can't see anything because he's too short. And the idea is that this is, it's equality if they're given the same size wooden pallet to stand on. The short kid still can't see. The middle kid, now he can see. And then the tall guy can see even better, if I'm remembering the illustration right. So, because I can't see it on the screen. But so the idea is that equality is just like this uniform standard that pays no mind to people's particular needs or merits or abilities, etc. And then equity, the idea is that everyone gets like the size box that they most need to see. So this is supposed to be equity because everybody is given what they actually need. Now the idea, again, like for people who use these terms and believe in them, I think the idea is that equity is supposed to be a more sensitive and appropriate response to a situation of inequality. And it's interesting to me that no one ever says inequity, but people still say inequality as the thing that you're trying to fix. And that equality is just like this kind of uniform, like standard, a kind of blunt instrument. And so in the essay, what I talk about is that the fact that, first of all, that's not what equality necessarily means. I mean, there's just like this kind of, it's become the way that this image circulates and this definition circulates. It's like this assumption that this is the objective meaning of equality. And then what I argue about it is that, the definition of equality as uniformity is basically a kind of conservative talking point. It's like what when Paul Ryan, that conservative congressman who sort of styled himself a intellectual, he liked to talk about how the United States government needs to focus on equality of opportunity, not equality of outcomes, meaning that instead of just giving all these undeserving poor people stuff, right, that would be a quality of outcomes, you need to level the playing field, as we like to say, and make it possible for everyone to have the same opportunity. And that's kind of the idea of equity, is that quality of opportunity concept. And the kind of caricature of equality that we see in the sort of DEI, diversity, equity, inclusion vocabulary, I think is kind of smuggling in this kind of right-wing claim about social equality as being about a kind of wasteful expenditure on the undeserving or the if it's not that sinister, perhaps it's at least about the idea that equality is sort of inefficient or ineffective. Giving people things is wasteful in the sense that it won't work, or it'll be wasteful, it'll waste valuable taxpayer dollars and resources and so forth. So I talk about it in those terms. And my other question, if we're still looking at the equity cartoon, you know, the one with the baseball game, I really wanted to kind of follow through on the analogy and just sort of ask, like, who paid to get into the game here, you know? And like, how do the people who are sitting in these comfortable seats relate to these freeloaders standing on boxes? Like, how does that figure in? I mean, it's a serious question, because what we are not talking about when we're kind of invoking diversity, inclusion, equity are the kind of, you know, structural determinants of people's access. Who built the stadium? You know, how much do the tickets cost? How do you get in? Why are these guys excluded from going to the game? These are the kind of like big political questions that we don't ask when we are simply talking about being included in an institution as it currently is constructed and as it currently exists.
Yeah.
And there's one more question.
There's one more question. If you want to, we've been going for a while, close to wrapping up. Do you want to just speak on this? We get the 2-minute notice from the people who are behind. People are running things behind the screen. Do you want to just say something quickly about why you wanted to write this more, why you felt the need to be more constructive rather than just.
Hey, one thing is, I kind of ran out of. Stupid business words. I mean, I probably haven't actually, but I kind of ran out of my patience for, you know, reading the Harvard Business Review or whatever.
You could have had a field day on. I mean, but you didn't. But the Robin DiAngelo types. I mean, you know, like that must make your head explode. I mean.
Yeah, but I mean, I wanted like.
I know, it's not.
I wanted to be concerned.
I
don't know. There's a lot of debunking to be done, but you know, there's also a lot of building to be done. And you know, the last book, what I said was that, you know, just like using the right words won't, you know, bring about socialism or, you know, destroy the neoliberal hegemon. But words are part of their power and a part of how they operate and a part of how we come to think about how we might fight them, you know. And so we need to be able to name these problems and to name what the ways we're fighting against them.
Yeah.
It's still true that, you know, coming to a more correct definition of socialism won't bring about socialism, but words are elements of the problems. They're elements of the struggles we're facing and fighting. So I guess I just wanted to.
I like the struggle. I mean, just very quickly, there seems to be some kind of struggle over the legacy of George Carlin. George Carlin, who was very precise in his critique of language, you know, he had all of those skits about, you know, how language has changed and whether he would have been, but he also did have a weird libertarian streak. You know, would he have gone in the direction of Bill Maurer and been a complete asshole? Or would he have been you? And like, because he did understand. understand power, and he did understand, you know, things for what they were in terms of class, in terms of patriarchy, in terms of the hatred of women, in terms of, you know, what abortion meant. And so there is that you are working in this long tradition of ideology critique, which is really, really wonderful.
Maybe we should end there. And thanks to the people behind the curtain.
Yeah.
Christine.
Thanks, everybody.
Making it work. And thank you, Greg.